Good morning, Harvest. Now, I know Britt paid you to do that, but thank you anyway. I appreciate it. It's good to be with you guys. I can't think of a better way to start the beginning of the year than to be in the house of the Lord with the Lord's people, giving him praise and honor and glory as he deserves. So I'm glad you guys made it out this morning. Thankful to be here and love the opportunity to share with you from God's word and something that he's been stirring in my own life these past, really, year and a half. This message kind of comes out of a lot of stuff I've been going through. So, you know, I don't know about you, but as we dawn a new year, I found myself having a deja vu moment this past week. Thinking, all right, it's 2022. I sure hope it's not like 2021. I don't know about you, but I can remember a year ago thinking, wow, it's 2020's finally going to be over. All the political tensions and racial tensions and this COVID thing, 2021's going to be so much better. And I feel myself hoping the same thing for 2022. Maybe you do. I don't know. I find myself asking this question, you know, Lord, in all that you've been doing this past year, what are you exactly doing? Like, have you ever found yourself in that position, asking that question in your life? Lord, what are you doing? It's easy to say that with this big season of COVID we've been in and just all the things that have been affected from schooling to travel to family time. Lord, what are you doing? We can ask that in smaller circumstances. As I was out there last night at 9 o'clock with my children shoveling the driveway, their first time ever shoveling snow. Me going, I could be in 65 and sunny, Lord, had you not moved me from Arizona right now. Well, Lord, what are you doing? Every Sunday, Bears fans ask, Lord, what are you doing? Don't worry, you're playing my Giants today. You should win this one. We're even worse. But we can get to that point in life pretty easily. Lord, what are you doing? Lord, I don't understand. Maybe you're there right now. My guess is at some point you've been there in the last 2 years. Maybe you, like me, you've been there a lot. Lord, what are you doing? Lord, I had all these great plans. It's not going that way. In fact, Lord, it's going the exact opposite of what I had planned. Lord, what are you doing? I don't get it. I don't understand. Everything that's gone on in Harvest these last 3 or 4 years, Lord, what are you doing? I don't get it. I don't understand. Maybe in this season you've lost your job or you've lost loved ones. Lord, what are you doing? Well, you're not alone in that question, folks, by any means. It's one we all ask, I think, often in our faith, and it's an okay question to ask, but we can't stay there. And I share all this because I want to share with you from Jeremiah this morning. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open up to Jeremiah 32 or swipe your screens, whatever you need to do, but get there to Jeremiah 32 this morning. If you don't know Jeremiah's story, he's a guy who basically lived out, Lord, what are you doing? He was asked to preach to Israel, right? And at this point in their history, Israel had fully rejected God. They had turned their back on God. They were now under siege because they had turned their back on God. And Jeremiah was called to preach to these people, and they wouldn't listen. I couldn't imagine coming here or showing up at any church and preaching, knowing nobody is going to listen. One of the things I love about Harvest is you're hungry for truth. You're hungry for God's word. But Jeremiah preached for decades and nobody listened. Talk about a Lord, what are you doing moment. Lord, what are you doing life? And now they're under siege. Lord, wait a minute. So I'm going to preach to these people. They're going to reject you. They're going to reject me. And oh, by the way, you're going to let us be overthrown by a foreign nation that is even worse. Lord, what are you doing? And then to top it all off, if it could get any weirder for Jeremiah, they're under siege. He's going to be taken into captivity or killed. He doesn't know. The Lord says to him, hey, Jeremiah, I want you to buy some property. I want you to go out and buy some property. You're never going to live on it, but I want you to buy this property. Like, I'm not joking. Look at this in Jeremiah 32, verse 6. Jeremiah said, the word of the Lord came to me. Behold, Hanamel, the son of Shalom, your uncle, will come to you and say, buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours. Then Hanamel, my cousin, came to me in the court of the guard in accordance with the word of the Lord and said to me, buy my field. God is telling him to buy him field. He's about to be, again, taken out of the country. He's not going to own this land. Everything going on in his life, he has the right. He, of anybody I've ever read about or met, has the right to go, God, what in the world are you doing? But he doesn't. He continues to explain the story of buying the land. Now go down to verse 17. The rest of this, he'd been explaining the story, and he was faithful, and he bought the land. And actually, verse 16 with me, he goes on to say this, and this is where we'll be this morning. It says, after I had given the deed of purchase to Baruch, the son of Neriah, I prayed to the Lord, saying, ah, Lord God, it is you who have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. He goes on to talk about the steadfast love of the Lord. He goes on to recount the miracles and the wonders that God did in Egypt. He doesn't sit there and complain and whine and say, God, what are you doing? God, why am I buying this field? Why am I preaching to people who won't listen, Lord? What are you doing? He says, none of that. I have no doubt he was thinking those things and feeling those things. He goes to a place of praise and a place of worship. We're learning a beautiful lesson from Jeremiah this morning. Of instead of sitting in our confusion, instead of sitting in our questions, which again are okay to ask and to wonder, of resetting his heart, of resetting his mind, and resetting his focus so that he doesn't get overwhelmed with all of his questions, so he doesn't get discouraged or lose hope with all of his questions. He resets himself vertically. Look at how he opens. He says, ah, Lord God. And that little two-letter phrase, ah, is something we'd often would skip over, but it's I'm married to an English teacher. My wife teaches English, and so I have to learn about English even though I was a C student in high school in it. And those two letters are what we call an interjection, right? It's an independent word that conveys passion and emotion. And in this moment, what we see is a man who, amidst his confusion, gets excited as he looks to God Most High, as he resets his focus vertically. He gets excited. Ah, Lord God, Adonai Yahweh, he says. And Yahweh, if you're familiar with that Old Testament word, right, that's the covenant name of God. That name conveys more about God than any other name in the Old Testament. One of the things that it communicates, it comes from the verb, which means to exist or to be. So in that name is where we know that God is self-existent, self-sufficient. God needs nothing and has everything at his disposal, right? He has the power to make all things, so therefore he has all that he needs, though he needs nothing. He has all that he wants. He goes on to elaborate further in the same verse, right? He says, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power. Jeremiah isn't just resetting himself. He's picking something specific to reset himself on, to realign himself with, and it's the power of God. He's basically saying to the Lord, hey, there's nothing you can't do. Lord God, I don't get all of this that's going on around me, but there's nothing that you can't do, and that I know. And so that I'm going to cling to. In the midst of what I don't know, in the midst of what I don't understand, I'm going to cling to what I do know. There is nothing that you cannot do, God. It's what I call a vertical reset, resetting my heart, my mind, and my soul. In this case, reminding myself that God has all power. He is infinite in his power. There is nothing that he cannot do. Jeremiah would elaborate earlier in this same book. Listen to this from Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 12. It is he who made the earth by his power, who established the world by his wisdom, and by his understanding he stretched out the heavens. When he utters his voice, there's a tumult of waters in the heavens. And he makes the mist rise from the ends of the earth. He makes lightning for the rain, and he brings forth the wind from his storehouses. Jeremiah is taking a moment to remember all of this, saying, I don't get everything going on around me, but I get this and I can focus on this. God, did you catch that last part? God has wind in his storehouses full of wind. Job, in fact, tells us that God has storehouses full of snow. I just wish he would keep it there. It looks great in the mountains, not in my driveway. All I have in my shed is an extra hose. It's not going to do me much good, right? But God has storehouses full of this stuff. In fact, verse 20, he says, you have shown signs and wonders in the land of Egypt. Jeremiah is resetting himself and focusing on the fact that there's nothing that our God cannot do. Folks, we know this. We have the entirety of God's word before us. We don't know just these things. We know about Jesus and his life, that he raised the dead, that he healed lepers, that he healed the sick and cast out demons. He calmed a storm with one word. I don't know about you, but maybe a great way to start this year is about recapturing our wonder and our awe of God. With all that has gone on in the last few years, not just in our nation, but even in our church, to recapture the wonder of who God is so we don't lose sight of that. So that no matter what comes our way this year, we can keep our eyes focused on God Most High and the fact that there's nothing that he cannot do. You know, last year, this past year, I read a handful of books, and three of them, unrelated, different authors, but in God's providence for me, had a very similar message, and the message was simple. It was this: stop listening to yourself and preach the gospel to yourself. We get overwhelmed because we lose sight of God. We tend to give in or quit or get confused because we lose sight of God. We so often deal with stress and anxiety and worry because we lose sight of God, and we need to recapture that wonder. And we do that by preaching the gospel to ourselves, by doing what Jeremiah is doing and realigning ourselves vertically and putting our eyes back on God. There's nothing that he cannot do. And so this year going forward, we need to make sure that we trust him. How do we do that? Well, I want to look at three ways that we can better trust him, or why we can trust him in the year. Look back at those opening words, "Ah, Lord God." I said earlier, it's Adonai Yahweh. And Adonai is the plural of majesty, right? The singular form of Adonai means master or ruler over all. But this is the plural, right? Saying God isn't just ruler over an area. God is ruler over all things. He's master over all things. He's the supreme authority over all things. He's in control of all things. That's who God is. He doesn't just influence them. He is guiding them, and he's in control of all that is going on. And that's the first reason we can trust God. We can trust him in his power, because it means that he is in control of all that is happening in my life. That one word conveys that he is Adonai over all things. He is in control of all things. Therefore, he's in control of all that's going on in my life. Whether I understand it or not, whether I even like it or not, he is in control, and he knows what he's doing. We don't have time to get into his perfect and infinite wisdom or his complete and perfect goodness, but he knows what he's doing, and it's always best and it's always right. Nothing is too big for God. Maybe you're facing one of the biggest challenges you've ever faced, but nothing is too big for God. Nothing's too small or too inconsequential or routine or mundane. Matthew chapter 10 tells us this: a sparrow doesn't fall to the ground without him knowing, but you are more valuable than many sparrows. Did you know that 13.7 million birds will die today? And God knows about every single one of them. 13.7 million. And God knows about every single one of them. And you are far more valuable than any bird, than any sparrow. You are far more valuable than any bird or any sparrow. He is in control, and he knows what's going on. He knows what you're going through. Life may not be going according to your plans, but he knows. What in your life right now isn't going according to your plans? Maybe it's small, maybe it's big, but he knows, and he's paying attention. Are you maybe unemployed for the first time in a long time? Are you facing financial challenges that you hadn't planned on this year? Have you had to maybe live off your savings or eat up your savings? He knows, and he's paying attention. Are you battling health issues this year? Has COVID taken a toll maybe on somebody you love? Maybe you've lost a loved one to that or something else. What kind of emotional and physical challenges are you facing because of everything we've dealt with this year? He knows, he's paying attention, he's working in it and through it and guiding it, folks. It's always easier to say this when you're not in the midst of it, I know that. In fact, I don't have time for my full story, but a year and a half ago, as Britt shared, we were living in Arizona. I was at what I was hoping was the last church I would ever pastor. My hope was to pastor that church till I was old and gray and could hand it off to some young buck who could take it into the whole next level, far beyond what I could do. That was my hope and my prayer, to stay there till I died. I was already in retirement country, so why leave? Just stay there till I retired, right? That was my hope. And then last summer, our elders began to discuss closing the church. I talked with every mentor that I had had, every coach that I had had, every pastor that I knew. Every one of them says, you guys are doing all the right things. You just live in a community that is hard, hard ground. And they just don't seem to want the gospel. And so we found ourselves a year and a half ago discussing closing the church, which is what we ended up doing. But as we began to discuss it, I thought, we're moving again. I don't want to move again, Lord. I don't want to move again. I don't want to start over at another church again. I don't want to have to make friends again. I don't want to have to find another doctor again. I don't want to have to do any of that new stuff again. A new God to change my oil, Lord. Amy's going to have to find another job. And we're leaving the kids' friends. Lord, I don't want to do this again. Lord, I just wanted to sit here and make disciples till I'm old and gray. Why can't we do this, Lord? What are you doing, Lord? That was my summer of 2020 on top of COVID. And folks, I will confess, I failed at what I'm preaching to you two summers ago. This is a lesson that came out of that summer because I failed at it miserably. I had lost sight of the Lord. I had been asking that question and not resetting myself vertically. And I became a complainer and a whiner, and my wife graciously confronted me and challenged me in all of that. It's not easy, I get it. It's not easy to trust, but to remember that truth that He is in control, even if I don't get it, even if I don't like it, He is in control and He knows what He's doing. If you're struggling to trust the Lord, it's usually one of two reasons, right? Why do we struggle to trust somebody? We don't know them, or they've broken our trust. The Lord's never breaking your trust, never has, never will, can't, will not. So if you don't know Him, then maybe you need to, like Jeremiah, remind yourself who He is. Let me ask you this, how has He guided you? If you're in one of those seasons now, can you remember other seasons like this that you remember and you saw Him take care of you, you saw Him provide, you saw Him lead, you saw Him guide and do all that He does? We have a faithful God, folks. For those of you that have been here for 3 or 4 or 5 or more years, my guess is 3 years ago you were asking, God, what are you doing to my church? Our pastor's gone. People are leaving in mass. Lord, what are you doing to my church? Is my church still going to be here in another month? Amy and I watched from afar, having loved Harvest. We were part of a harvest. We had gone through this training center. Had spent months here. It was breaking our hearts watching from afar. I can't imagine what it was like to be here and go, God, what are you doing to my church? I thought you were building your church, Lord. As hard as that was, remember where you are now. Remember all of the baptisms that we've seen this year, all the new faces that have come in this year, the people that have prayed to receive Christ this year. Remember all of that. God has provided faithfully. He's filled the holes. The church is being rebuilt again, and He continues to build it, but yet it's healthier and stronger in so many ways. He is in control, and He has been this entire time, and He knows exactly what He's doing, folks. I want to respond to one thing that I know often comes up with this when we say that God is in control, John. Yeah, I get that. So therefore, He's never going to give me more than I can handle. This is a question I get every time I talk about this, so I just want to respond briefly to it, folks. And I'm sorry if I'm going to burst your bubble, but that's just not true. It doesn't say that anywhere in Scripture, that God will not give me more than I can handle. In fact, it teaches the exact opposite. He's going to give you more than you can handle. Last 2 summers ago was more than I could handle. Remember Moses' story? All of his excuses? God, you're giving me more than I can handle. I can't handle this. I can't go home to these people and tell them what to do. I'm a horrible speaker. They don't like me. I don't like them. I can't do this, Lord. It's more than I can handle. And you know what his response was? I am that I am. I am Yahweh, and I am with you. I am with you. It is more than you can handle, Moses, but I will be with you. Go into all the world and make disciples, and I will be with you. I love what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Paul's words, again, this is the Lord through Paul. We were so utterly burdened beyond our strength. The Lord gave us more than we could handle. But we relied on God who raises the dead. God gave us more than we can handle, but we relied on Him. We trusted Him, and He gave us all that we needed, which leads me to the next point is this. Look back at the text, right? It is you who have made the heavens and the earth. He spoke creation into existence, folks. I don't know about you, but I often gloss over the first chapters of Genesis. Yep, read this story, been there before. We read about God creating in Scripture, we gloss over that. But He spoke it into existence. Go back and read Genesis 1 if you haven't read it recently. And it just simply says, and the Lord said, multiple times in the first chapter, and the Lord said, and there was day and night. And the Lord said, and the earth was there. And the Lord said, and there were water. And the Lord said, and there were plants. And the Lord said, and there were animals. And the Lord said, and there were people. He spoke it into existence from nothing. Jeremiah, talk about refocusing yourself on who God is. He spoke it, and it came to being from nothing. I don't know about you if you've ever built anything. I did not grow up in a house where I was taught to do a lot of building or a lot of car work. But 2 years ago, Amy and I decided we wanted to get a new dining room set. And so we found a really nice table, but it didn't come with chairs, so we found older chairs. And we found these chairs, they had these white cushions on them. They were really, really ugly, right? And you can see, well, you can see the finished product for yourself, right? The white was what we got, and the brown is what we ended up with. If you like it, Amy gets all the credit. But I didn't just like buy the white chair and put it down and speak to it. Finish. I didn't do that, and we all know had I done it, nothing would have happened anyway, right? I had to go out and buy a couple tools I didn't have. I didn't have a nail puller and a couple other things. We had to rip off all that old stuff. These springs, like you sat in them and you went to the ground. We had to go buy the new top. We had to buy the foam. I had to buy the plywood, all the tacks, all the staples, pneumatic staple gun. I didn't have any of these things. It would have been great had I been able to just, you know, point at it. But when we make anything, we have to go buy stuff. God doesn't, folks. There was nothing, and God spoke, and there was everything. God has every resource available. And if he has it, and we as his children, it means that we will also have all that we need. Or put it a different way, it's this. He will provide all that I need for whatever I will face. Going back to the fact that, again, you will face things that will be beyond your ability, but he will give you what you need when you face it. Everything you need. This gets back to the fact that, again, my God can do everything. He has infinite power. He's doing this for us every day, by the way. Too often when we're in a good season, we miss this. We miss the fact that he's giving us the wisdom that maybe we need for those decisions, the patience we need with somebody. But whatever you need, he will give you. He has storehouses of all of these things. And let's not forget his Spirit. The Spirit of the living God dwells in you. So when you need strength or hope or courage, it's already there. In abundance. In fact, it's a never-ending supply already dwells in you. You need peace in this season, joy in this season, hope in this season. It dwells inside of you through his Spirit, a never-ending supply. Grace, mercy, comfort, and let's not forget the biggest gift. Just look around this room. He's given you a church family. He's given us so much already, and yet he gives us everything we need for whatever we will face. Paul wrote in his letter to the Philippians, right, chapter 4, and my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Not some needs, every need. If you're not getting it, it may just be not his timing, or it may be something you want but you don't need. Let's never forget that. But he will give us everything. 15 years ago, I was pastoring in Lake Zurich. I was at a small Leaf-Free church in Lake Zurich, and we had a full-time lead pastor. I was the associate. We had a part-time high school pastor, part-time junior high pastor, 2 part-time staff. Loved this church, loved being a part of this church. And at some point, our elders decided we were meeting in a gym. We had a multi-purpose room gym. And they really believed if you build it, they will come. And so we put on a huge new worship center with a whole bunch of new classrooms. We were building for the future, and God was going to fill this place like crazy. And a year into this building being open, we realized we were going to lose it to the bank. We couldn't pay for it. And so they let everybody except the senior pastor go. That was their choice to try to hold on to the building. To those of us that were on staff, this was completely unexpected. We didn't know, like, they had been talking about this, but we didn't know. And at the moment, felt like a blindside. Now, they graciously gave me a severance. They had told us this in July, and they gave me 3 months of severance that would take me through about September, early October. Well, if you ever have any friends who are pastors and you've been with them as they've gone through a pastoral search, it normally takes 6 to 12 months. It took Harvest almost 2 years to get Pastor Jeff here. It takes a while. And so being the guy looking for the job, that's hard. When your severance is 3 months and you have to wait 6 to 12 months and your wife is staying at home because you have a 2 and a 4-year-old and she's been staying at home and so you don't have many savings. You've been paying all your bills and meeting all your bills, but you don't have a savings. And now it's November and the severance has run out, and now it's Christmas and severance has run out. And you have to buy Christmas gifts, so you want to buy Christmas gifts for your 2 and your 4-year-old, but there's nothing in your bank account at all. Again, I failed in this season. I didn't do well in this season of what I'm sharing with you today. This is a lesson I'm learning. My wife, Amy, was awesome. If you haven't met her, by the way, my better half by far. Don't waste your time getting to know me. Meet her. I'm telling you right out the gate. But Amy was great in this season. I was not. I was angry with the Lord. I was bitter with the Lord. Was questioning ministry. Lord, if you did this to me, why would I want to keep going in ministry? He had plans. I didn't know them. She said, just get over here and pray with me. And so we just kept praying, Lord, you know, provide, provide, provide. And we were coming home from somewhere, probably a friend's house, and there's an envelope taped to our front door. Let me clarify. We told nobody. We didn't even tell our parents because I was stubborn. I wouldn't ask for help. I didn't want anybody to know we were in financial trouble because I didn't want them to graciously give us a gift. Oh, well, you're only helping because I told you. Yes, my pride, I confess. So we told nobody of this, but God knew. And God makes promises. He promises to provide when we need. And we came home and there was an envelope on our front door with enough money to pay our bills for the month of December and buy our gifts, Christmas gifts. It's one of the best Christmases we ever had. And 3 months later, he provided me with a new job. He took care of us in that season. We didn't go into any kind of debt. Every bill was paid. Jobs would be dropped in my lap that might just be for a weekend, but it'd be enough money for whatever we needed in that season, folks. I know it's always easier when you're not in those seasons, and it's always harder to reset vertically when we're in those seasons. So remember this morning, remember what the Lord has done for you, so that like Jeremiah, we don't lose sight in the midst of it, and we reset ourselves vertically, and don't lose hope. And like I said, he's doing this every day, by the way. Every day he is giving you what you need. It might just be wisdom for decision making. It might be wisdom in parenting. It might be giving you the ability to forgive somebody that you've wronged. It might be giving you the grace and the mercy to extend to somebody else who's hurt you. But every day he's giving us what we need. Let's not miss out on it. Everything you need is at his fingertips. He's got storehouses of it. His spirit lives in us, and he's going to give it to us every day. One last reason that we can trust the Lord. Last part of the verse, look at it with me if you still have your Bibles open. It says, nothing is too hard for you. Right? And the word hard really isn't a good word there because it really paints a picture more of nothing's too extraordinary. Like nothing, there's nothing you can't do is really the way to put it. There's nothing you can't do, Lord. Right? Confirming again that he has infinite power, that he can do all that he wills to do and wants to do. And this is one I know sometimes is hard even just to read about, because then why isn't he healing my loved one? Why isn't he doing this? I don't know. There is mystery in trying to understand God in his fullness, but we can know enough that we can trust him. You know, he would say later in the same chapter, and in fact, God would kind of respond back. He says in verse 27, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is anything too hard for me? No. He would say the same thing back to Sarah and Abraham. When Sarah laughed, found out God said she was going to get pregnant, she laughed in his face. And he says to Sarah, by the way, is anything too hard for me? I'm the Lord, Sarah. Nothing is too hard for him. But because nothing is too hard for him, that means that his plans for you, his plans for me, no one and nothing can stop or will stop his plans for you and me. Nobody can. Nothing is too hard for him. The Lord has plans for us. He has a will for us, and no one and nothing can stop it. No one and nothing will stop it. Folks, I look back to 1992 when I graduated college. I had a high school history teaching degree, and the Lord said, nope, you're going into ministry. And I worked for Youth for Christ in Rolling Meadows right out of college for ministry. But when the Lord called me, it was so crystal clear that I was supposed to go into ministry. I couldn't argue, I couldn't doubt. And I pulled the Moses moment. I made every excuse in the book, and the Lord just kept saying, am I God, am I God, am I God? And trust me. And Amy and I have had some very difficult seasons in ministry. And I have often thought of getting out of ministry. And the Lord has kept saying, John, it's my plans, it's my will, and no one and nothing is going to stop it. People don't want to hear the gospel, I'm going to take you somewhere else. Church isn't going to have enough money, I'm going to provide for you somewhere else and take you somewhere else. I have plans and nothing's going to stop that, John. No one and nothing, folks. Satan cannot stop the Lord's plans for you. Bad bosses, bad teachers, bad coaches can't stop God's plans for you. Abusive friends, abusive family members, neglectful parents can't stop God's plans for you. Sickness can't stop God's plans for you. Neither can death. You cannot stop God's plans for you. What he wills will come to fruition because he has all power. Right? Luke wrote it down, opening up his gospel. I love this. For nothing will be impossible with God. I was trying to think of like the things that are unstoppable in our world, right? If nothing can stop God's plans, then he is unstoppable. And he's going to work unstoppable things in my life, which is awesome. But what can I compare that to? I'm like, there really isn't anything. Like there was that movie about the unstoppable train that got stopped at the end. Maybe you didn't see it. Then I was thinking back, okay, I grew up here. We had Michael Jordan. He was unstoppable until he retired or played the Pistons early on. He was unstoppable all the time with the Pistons. And then if you're a football fan, right? Tom Brady, the guy's unstoppable. Ask Eli Manning if he's stoppable. Stopped him twice. Nobody and nothing is unstoppable. Living in Arizona 2 years ago, we had what was called the bushfire. That's not the type, that was the name. We like to name fires in Arizona. I don't know why. It was called the bushfire. Started 8 miles from our house. We saw it when it started. Calling our friends who lived out near there, making sure they were okay. Fortunately, it went away from our town up into the mountains. It burned for a month. 250,000 acres. And for that month, that felt unstoppable. Every day you just saw the sky filled with smoke. If the wind shifted, we got the smoke in town and you stayed inside. At night, you'd go out and you could just look into the mountains and you could see the glow of the flames. Seemed unstoppable for that month. There's nothing in this world that is unstoppable except our God. Nothing will stop God's plans for you. You know, I recently was rereading Job and I was reminded of what an awesome story that is. Yeah, it's a story of suffering, but the end result of where Job comes to after all of his suffering, well, if you haven't read it recently, reread it, especially the end, right? Job is living in this, God, what are you doing? God, I don't understand. And he's just living in that. If Job did anything wrong, which he's accused of not sinning, he just stayed in that moment. God, what are you doing? I don't get it. And then God would confront Job. Who are you to question me? Do you not know who I am? But I love Job's humble response towards the end. My glasses are right here. But I want to read this part to you because I just love it. I didn't bookmark it, though. Just give me a second. Right at the end of his story, he says this. This is after the Lord kind of confronted him. Job says this. And this, again, if you're in a season of suffering, it's a great book to find comfort in because Job, at the end of it, and by the way, when he says this, he is still covered head to toe in those boils, whatever he had. He looks disgusting. He smells disgusting. He's sitting there in burlap and ashes, and it's just nasty. So he hasn't been healed yet. He hasn't gotten anything back, like nothing. He's still in the midst of his misery, but this is what he says. Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me for which I did not know. Hear and I will speak. I will question you, and you make it known to me. I have heard of you, listen to this, I had heard of you by hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. It took his suffering for him to actually finally see the Lord. He knew all about him. He was one of the smartest people at the time of knowing all about God. He could tell you anything you wanted to know about God, but to actually experience it and live it. Did Job come to this point and recognize the power of God over all things? Who was I to question you? Even Job knew nothing could stop the Lord's plans. The Lord knows what he's doing. Folks, my hope is that when we'd come out of this, being better this year at recounting what the Lord has done, recounting what the Lord is doing in our lives and not forgetting so it becomes easier and easier and easier. Every time we come to that moment, Lord, what are you doing? Every time we come to that moment, Lord, I don't understand. You know what, I don't, but I'm going to reset myself vertically on who God is, focus on his power and all of there is to know about him. I've told you that in these seasons of my life in the past, I've kind of failed at this. I'm getting better, thank God. But I want to share one last idea with you before we wrap things up. So last 2 summers ago when we were in Arizona in the midst of closing our church and I was really confused and angry at the Lord. Again, my gracious wife Amy came up with an awesome idea. She went out and bought this ball jar. It's about 2 gallons in size, this glass clear ball jar, right? And she got these note cards and cut them in half, and they're different colors. And she said, all right, we're all kind of struggling a little bit in this season. Here's what we're going to do. We did this with our kids because they were home from college for the summer. Every time you see God at work, whether he provides for us miraculously, whether he protects us, whether he guides us, whether he makes clear the next step of our life, in any way that God, like we like to say, shows up in our lives, we're going to write it on a card, we're going to write the date on it, we're going to stick it in a jar. It was a great idea. It's what I needed. Because every day I walked through a room and I'd say, hey, there was nothing in there yesterday. Who put something in there? Tell me about that. And then I'd walk by again and, hey, there's three or four cards. Hey, what? Why? Where are those? Who wrote those? Talking to my kids. Who put those in there? What'd God do? And then I found myself adding one and found us adding another one. That still sits. That's sitting on our counter in our house. It's still sitting there. I failed at adding any since we've moved. I'll confess that. But it's still a great visual reminder to just walk through that room and see that and go, you know what? God takes care of us. God has all the power. God is guiding us. God is providing for us. Nothing will stop God's plans for us. It's a visual reminder in our house of the truths we're talking about this morning, that God is in complete and absolute control, folks. This is what I want you to know more than anything this morning, so that we, like Jeremiah, don't lose hope, don't lose sight of our one true God. Whatever he's going to do in 2022 for us this year, and I'm praying for huge things for me and my family, for us as a church. I want to see God blow the doors off. I want to see revival come to our suburbs. I want to see the lost saved and disciples made over and over and over again. But whatever he has for this year, I want to trust him in it. Whether it goes according to my plans or not, I want to trust him in it. And whatever happens, I want to be more in his plans than in mine, because his are the right ones. He will not stop guiding us because he is always in control. He will give us all that we need for whatever we face this year, folks. So let's go forth boldly and courageously. And nothing and no one will stop his plans for us, because there's nothing that he cannot do. The God that Jeremiah worshipped is the same God we worship. And he is leading. So let's be a people who follow him faithfully. Amen? Would you pray with me? Father, I just want to thank you this morning, and with Jeremiah, I want to give you praise. Lord God, Adonai Yahweh, you are the creator of all things. You spoke, and from nothing came all things. You knit us together in our mother's wombs. You've saved us. You've redeemed us. You've brought us back. You lived and you died so that we could live not just now, but for all eternity. You are God Most High over all things. And you continue to guide and control life. You continue to lead us and guide us and show us how to live. You continue to provide all that we need, and nothing will stop your plans for us. God, we praise you and thank you for all of this. The God of all power, of all wisdom, we praise you, God. And I pray for us. Help us, Lord. Help us to be men and women who do not lose sight of you, who when we do, we don't give up hope, but we come back to you and reset ourselves, reminding ourselves of who you are, the God of all power, the God of all wisdom, the God of all love, the God who is just and faithful, who keeps every promise. If you do anything in us this year, make us a people who do not lose sight of you, but we recapture our awe of who you are, God, the great and mighty God who can do all things, who guides us and provides for us, and who won't let anyone stop your plans for us. We thank you and we praise you in your great name, Jesus. Amen.